The show is about to start. Thank you for your cooperation. Enjoy the show, and please come back and visit us again.
Sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is what I feel when we're together. Brighter than a lucky penny when you're near. The rain goes, disappears, dear, and I feel so fine just to know that you are mine.
Absolutely. Sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows, and nothing but positivity on the 9 Years podcast as we shake off our dire start to the season and focus on nothing but the good things. I am Nick Draper, shortly to be joined by Stuart Deakins, and we'll be having a chat with our friends at Blackburn Rovers this week as we delve into their ownership problems and preview our forthcoming game at Ewood Park, whilst nothing could be more uplifting than our weekly game. Yes, we are super happy on the podcast this week because life is wonderful and watching AFC Wimbledon this season is nothing but joy and delight. And not at all like watching Chris Sutton give analysis on Watford matches. To begin with, though, our big question of the week. And Stu, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being, let's use Kevin Boris's scale from our Facebook Live video the other night, 1 being Lisa Riley and 10 being Rachel Riley, how happy should we be with the performance against Gillingham on Tuesday? Not the result, the performance.
Yeah, do you know what? If I was going to say out of 10, I would say I'll give us a 7, I reckon. And that was mainly because the tempo was right. You know, I go on about tempo all the time, don't I? But when you think about it, really, that tempo that we started at against Gillingham on Tuesday night should be the standard. That should be the bare minimum that we should do at home. You should take the game to the team that's coming visiting your place. So for that, I'll give them a 7. We just failed to get enough bodies in the box, which we go through as we talk about Gillingham. But I think we just failed to kill them off. You know, we made a few, made the error for the goal and stuff. But it's miles better. You know, if I was looking at Pompey, I'd probably say a 4 or 5. So we've definitely increased quite a lot, and we're getting there. You know, it's not Rome wasn't built in a day, so you won't all of a sudden just resolve everything we've got going wrong for us. But I would say a nice round 7, I reckon.
A nice round 7.
Not round, is it?
No, Lisa Riley is round. On the scale, then, a 7, what are we thinking? That's probably an Alex Jones off of The One Show. She's probably a 7, yeah?
Yes. Is she the Welsh bird, isn't she? Sorry, the Welsh lady,
yeah.
Sorry.
Yes, she is Welsh. She's not the Welsh. There's not just one Welsh woman.
Yeah, she's all right. One Show just keeps changing their presenters all the time, though, don't I? I don't understand why I keep doing that.
Don't really watch it that much, but there was Angela Scanlon. She was presenting for a while, and she'd be a bit further up the scale. I think she'd be close to an 8 or a 9, maybe. We're wildly off topic now.
Never.
I know. And we're only a couple of minutes in. Right, you talked about the tempo, how we started the game against Gillingham, and that was a big thing that Neil Lardy talked about. He said in his post-match interview, it was actually a very interesting post-match interview that Neil Lardy gave, key bit I took from him, although there was many, was the idea that he'd tried to change the style. He tried to give the team less information. Do you think by that he meant that he had tried to instigate this passing style and it hasn't really suited us? So he's probably said to the players, look, be a bit more direct and get the ball forward more quickly and get play. What do you think he actually changed?
Joe, it's interesting. I alluded to this on the Facebook Live after the game on Tuesday night, but it's as if Neil has got caught between playing the... Now, if you know anything about the FA badges now, they train you, don't they? The FA training book. So you'll go on an FA training course and you'll get the associated licence that you need. But it's like Neil's got caught in the way of... wants to play the way the FA courses encourage you to play, passing football and moving people around and creating overloads and playing between the lines. You know, we hear that. It's like he's got caught between that and then also playing the old school Wimbledon way that he was brought up on back in the 90s. So I think sometimes, you know, we've heard this before from him, when he just, you know, he just goes, I'm just going to go back to the basics. And basically, back to the basics is a high tempo, get the ball forward as quick as possible. And that's what we did. So I don't know. Do you know what? I think sometimes you just over... I think if you had a game Saturday, I think the system that Neil wants to play, you could gradually train it into your players. You could gradually get the system to work. But when you think, including Tuesday night's game against Gillingham, it's five games in 18 days. So really, you're not going to train it into them. You're just going to have to get them playing really old school, get it forward, take a touch, put it into the channel, and off you go.
Do you think then he's overestimated the ability then of the squad? Is that what you're saying?
Do you know what? We've all said the squad on paper is probably the best squad we've had.
It is, but does that necessarily mean that they still have the ability to be able to play this new style?
Well, that's the thing you're finding out, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? You can have people with good technical ability, but actually can they then take information in that you're giving them? And that's what he's basically saying, that maybe they can't. You would have thought people like Liam Trotter, Jimmy Abdu, been around the block, Cody McDonald, either. You would have think that they've played under enough managers to have a bit of a savvy, wouldn't you? Do you know what I mean? But, you know, for whatever reason. But the 4-3-3 is... We still played it. We still played it on Tuesday night, but we didn't play it in the slow, methodical, trying to... Before, and I've said to you before, haven't I? You know, we try and take a touch. We try and move people around, play a bit slow. And I sometimes now actually start to think that that's what actually what Neil Hardy wanted. And actually, last night, he took away all that, didn't he? You know, he openly admitted that. He stripped it all down. And look at the performance we got. And look at the tempo we played with last night. Or Tuesday night, as I should say.
Tuesday night. But why then still, despite that, why this reticence to move away from this 4-3-3 formation? Like, we switched late in the game on Tuesday to essentially it was a 4-2-4, wasn't it? Why didn't we do that earlier? And in fact, why did we not try the 4-4-2 and have Barcham and Carja wide as wide midfielders before that? Why this insistence on this 4-3-3, like, as you said there, not getting enough members or not getting enough players in the box?
But do you know what? I think Neil Hardy's been with us long enough for us all to know that he can be a bit stubborn. I think we all know that in him. But do you know what? He's got a right to be stubborn. He's the manager of the football team. So he's got a right to have an opinion and stubbornness that's the way I want to play. But I think it's also showing now that, do you know what? Sometimes you've just got to get... It's getting to the time now where you've got to get points. You know, you can't keep going, well, I want to play 4-3-3 and we'll eventually get there. I think he's realised now that if you don't start putting points on the board, then the fans are going to start getting on your back. So, you know, the best thing about Gillingham was that actually the fans got behind the team. But do you know what? The fans got behind the team. There was more singing in 4 or 5 minutes than there was in the whole of the Pompey game, wasn't there?
Well, that's because in the first 5 minutes, we had already had as many shots against Gillingham as we had in the entirety of the Portsmouth game.
It was, but do you know what? I was on the edge of my seat, which I can honestly say, I don't think I have been that much this season. I don't think I've actually, even when we beat Doncaster, I don't think I've been on the edge of my seat where you anticipated that goal was coming. You know, when you build up that pressure and you can just tell the defending team are dropping so far back that actually, do you know what? It's just a matter of time before you score. That's what it felt like. It was interesting because I was sitting just behind the players that weren't playing. So Paul Robinson, Darius Charles, Jimmy Abdu. And do you know what? Paul Robinson, for all the stuff, you can tell he loves the game because he was on the edge of his seat. It was chucking it down with rain. I'd moved a few seats back because I was getting wet. But he stayed there like a typical Millwall legend, as we all know he is. But on the edge of his seat, willing the ball to go into the net. And that was quite good to see, actually, from him. But everyone's on the edge of their seat. That's what you want.
I wasn't on the edge of my seat because if I was, I'd have got wet. Because in the third row back where I was sat, the rain, the wind was blowing it all. Oh, I tell you, nothing worse than that. Nothing worse than when the moisture blows into your face. It's really irritating. Anyway, of course, target man then. Should we talk about this? I'll tell you for why. Because the goal we did score, a first half goal. We've not mentioned that yet, actually. We should do. We scored a first half goal.
Yay.
For the first time at King's Meadow in the league since January. First time at all in the league since March the 4th. However, it actually came at a time when our early pressure had subsided a little bit. And Gillingham was starting to impose themselves a little bit. And how did they do that? Because they had a big man up front that meant the ball was sticking up there for about 10, 15 minutes before we scored. And Neil Hardy has now finally admitted after the Portsmouth game that we were in the market in the market for a target man, but we could not find one, or we couldn't, or if we did, they didn't want to sign for us for whatever reason. So what does that suggest to you, that come January, or even when the loan window opens, that that's what we'll be doing? That's what we'll be getting in?
Possibly. It's interesting, though, isn't it? Because the story just keeps on changing with Neil RD. Like,
it is interesting.
It's interesting, I suppose. Most things are in life.
Certainly on this podcast, yes.
But correct me if I'm wrong, but that message has been so clouded about, we've got enough now. You know, Neil Cox was saying, no, that's how business done, and nothing else is going to happen. Neil RD didn't really go on much about a target man. Talked about the fact that he bought a championship striker in Kwesi Appiah. And then all of a sudden, now he chucks in that, well, we were after the target man, but we just couldn't get the ones that we wanted. So it's sort of like, what was it, Joe? Was it a bluff? Was it anything like that? But the funny thing was, actually, Gillingham cheated. They actually had two target men in Wilkinson and Eames. And I thought Eames was quite impressive. I really did. I thought typical old-style... Oh, right, he was an Andy Carroll lookalike, wasn't he? He lasted longer than Andy Carroll did, so give him credit for that. But they did. They always had an out ball, didn't they? Always had an out ball. And it's something that we haven't had this season. But then again, we didn't really need it on Tuesday night either, because Gillingham's defence was probably the worst I've seen in the league.
Would you really say that, though? Because...
their defence.
Well, we only scored once against them, and it was a bit of a fluky one in the end as well. You can look at their goalkeeper making a number of saves, but they were sticking bodies in the way and blocking us. And the other thing maybe we didn't or haven't said about Gillingham is they had the man sent off, and they kept those two big men up front, didn't they? Because they had the three in midfield that kept things, because we kept things too narrow.
Yeah. Yeah, dude. I stand by it. I still think they're a terrible team. They're not a great team. I think the reason we didn't score...
They'll go down.
Yeah, the reason we didn't score was we didn't get enough bodies in the box. We stuck to the 4-3-3, but we had Lyle crossing balls in to where Lyle, you want Lyle in there. You know, we got a bit obsessed with... It was like there was only two players on the pitch at one point, which was Barry Fuller and Lyle Taylor, because all we seemed to do was just interchange between them two as if that was where... the breakdown was going to happen, and it didn't in the end. And it wasn't, you know, there were some great chances, but we didn't get enough people in the box. And yes, they did put their bodies on the line, but that's what you expect from a League One team. You know, you expect a team to not fold. You know, teams don't fold in our league like they did in the old Conference South days or Rome Prem. You know, the teams would just fall to pieces. So you expect them to put their bodies on the line, but I think it was more through a case that we didn't get enough bodies in the box. And as you said, when we went to 4-2-4 and brought Edgar Carter on, all of a sudden Chuck Lyle in the middle with Cody. And if only... hindsight's a great thing, but if you'd only done that maybe 70 minutes, on a 70 minute, and we'd done that and had 20, 25 minutes at them, I think they'd have caved in.
Can I throw a spanner into the works a little bit and say, as much as we talk about the shots we had and the attempts we had, which was great because we've been crying out for them and we've had a really dull start to the season attacking-wise, and we haven't caused goalkeepers problems, and the Portsmouth game was, I don't think it can get any worse than that Portsmouth game. So for all that, yes, I'm very happy. I think we did the right thing. We took the game to Gillingham from the off and we create chances and we were unlucky in that regard and all this. But actually, the reason we've not won that game is not because we missed chances or the goalkeeper had a blinder. It's because we've fallen asleep on the stroke of half-time and given away another horrendous goal against 10 men as well.
Goal is a car crash of a goal. It's just not... Sometimes you can accept, you and I, sometimes you can accept if you get a great... If you get a good move, you know, a well-constructed move, or someone hits a 25-yarder, it's a weldy, you can sort of go, oh, Joe, what a great strike. You can always dissect goals, you know, when you know, look at when Cole scored up against us for Fleetwood. You can still, great strikes, but you can still dissect them and go, actually, we let him get into the area. But crikey, the goal on Tuesday night was just a car crash. You know, they gave us problems all night long with set pieces, so anything around the box, throw-ins, corners. And all I do is chuck a ball in, George Frankham goes to head it. I think George got a bit confused because, of course, he's had his bun chopped off, hasn't he? So I think George went ahead of it and thought, because he normally has quite a lot of air in his head, that he thought he probably got a good head on it and actually missed it. Missed the header, Andy Hartigan gets done by Clare running on his blind side, and then he just scuffs it, goes along the floor, hits the post, goes in. You're like, that is just a car crash of a goal.
What about the goals against Portsmouth then, looking back?
Oh, do we have to go that far back?
Well, we've not mentioned it, and we do have a few things to discuss because we're going to talk about refereeing and penalty decisions and things like that, and that all goes back to Portsmouth.
Yeah.
And the first goal, right, this penalty, this is the problem, isn't it? Because Portsmouth were a team that came for a 0-0 draw and ended up winning 2-0. That probably sums up how bad you were. And I think earlier you might have given us a 4 or a 5 on the scale. I think you're being very generous.
Probably.
Very, very generous. And let's talk about that, though, the goal. Another, and it's come from that part of the pitch again, hasn't it? In that sort of a ball into the area around between Barry Fuller and Paul Robinson.
Yeah, it's a diagonal ball, but it's as straight as anything. So it's a diag ball, but it's basically played in just behind Paul Robinson. But
it's a diagonal ball that's straight as anything.
Well, it's a straight diagonal ball. Does that make sense?
No, not really.
Well, so what I mean is, I call a straight ball on the centre spot a straight ball into the area, whereas this was to the right of the halfway line, but as straight as anything you can get as a diagonal ball, if that makes any sense.
Okay. All right, okay.
But what in that situation, what you want to happen is for Robbo to go and attack the ball, and then Barry Fuller to cover in behind. But what seems to happen is that Robbo gets caught by the movement of Brett Pittman, and in the end, Barry Fuller's the one that's got to go and make the challenge, but he's wrong side. So a straight ball has just caused us all sorts of problems. And then Barry Fuller does have two. He has two hands and pushes Barry Pittman. Is it Barry Pittman? No, it isn't. Brett Pittman. Sorry.
How can you forget a name like Brett?
Mr. Pittman.
Brett
anyway.
Hart.
Brett Hart, of course. But yeah, Brett Pittman's wise enough. Yeah, we all know he's done a Superman dive to enhance the push. But there was a push. it's all day long. There's a push there. And it's just...
Well, you said it there, enhance the push. Well, yeah, because there was a push.
There was. If you've got your hands up, you're encouraging someone to make more of what it is. Mm. You're encouraging. And for people saying it's harsh and he made a meal of it, yes, he did. And you know what? You're hoping sometimes that referees, in a way, book the person for really over-dramatic, an over-dramatic simulation. But it's a penalty. It's a penalty because we got ourselves into an almighty mess on a real basic ball, really.
And then the second goal, we won't spend too much time on that because that's just one of those things. You know, 99 times out of 100, Anthony Hardscoot gets his foot behind that and out the box and away. But it's just that one time and they take advantage of it. We didn't look like we were ever going to score in that game.
No, it didn't. It wasn't a game-changing moment, was it? Do you know what I mean? You saw, yes, all right, 1-0, you've always got a chance. But we had reorganised, hadn't we, due to the acts of fuggery against us. It's going to happen. Aaron Hartigan, to be honest with you, he got a lot more credit from the way he responded after making a mistake. So fair play to the lad who's had a great week, hasn't he?
He has. People that have not had a great week, referees. The standard of refereeing we've had this week, I'm just going to sit back and let you talk about it, Stu.
It's just...
Should we go back to our scale of 1 to 10? Where would you put it between Lisa Riley and Rachel Riley? It's certainly nowhere near Rachel Riley.
It's just... Joel, I hate moaning about referees because you, of course, always see it from a biased position. You do. You know, you can't help that by having, as we've said before, the blue and yellow tinted glasses. You can't help but having a biased opinion. But some of the decisions, you know, the elbow from Brett Pittman. You know, Robbo's got claret all around his face, and he doesn't react to much, does he? If he reacts, you know, he's been around the game long enough to know when someone's done him, and that's what he felt. Callum's just been absolutely assaulted, hasn't he? It's just...
Well, did you see him on Tuesday?
No, but I do hear he had... Yeah. He had a resemblance of a boxer who'd just been in a right, you know.
Oh yeah, it was
12 rounds.
A black eye and a half, yeah.
But it's just what it's not just a referee in some of these situations. That decision was made with the assistant referee who was running that line on the Pompey side. The fourth official could never wait to get involved in everything, do you know what I mean? And then when they get questioned, they just can't see it. And the referee, I just don't see how he cannot see that. The guy has led with his elbow and totally wiped out, you know, Callum Kennedy. It's just a shocking, shocking thing. And then, of course, you know, you've got to top it off. You've got Burgess doing an overhead kick and literally wiping out Robbo, and then obviously him going off. And that's just in the Pompey game. You know, if you go to Tuesday night's game, the Liam Trotter, which could potentially be saying, I've watched it again back today. It's unreal.
To be honest with you, we knew at the time, though. And
yeah, you see it, don't you?
The referee is right there. He's right on the spot. And I don't know what he thinks has happened.
I think he knows what's happened. And Neil Ardy called it 100% right. He knows what's happened. He knows if he gives a free kick, he's got to make a decision. Because when it was, if you look at it back in slow motion, it's technically two-footed. The studs are not off, but it's two-footed. He's trying, you know, Liam Trott's been very smart. It's two-footed. And also, if you watch a reaction, whatever, what we'll tell you all day long about his reactions. So Barry Fuller, when he gave away the penalty, he looked sheepish. He looked like he'd done something wrong. It's like when you get caught when you're younger nicking something, you know, nicking some chocolates or nicking a biscuit when you shouldn't have it. You know you're guilty. You have no idea. You know you're guilty. You've been caught. Do you know what I mean? So Barry Fuller had that look of, oh, ref, I've done something wrong here. What, you know. Their defender, if you look at it on the slow-mo, it's absolutely classic. He, when he fouls, he actually then lands on his sort of knees and on his front. And he actually is in, he literally gives up. He thinks he's got done. He thinks it's free kick. He then gets up and all of a sudden he realises that the referee's not blown it and then tries to push his defence out. Is it, the players are the best judges. You can tell by players' reactions when they've done something wrong. But yeah, and also just to top it off with the referee, he blows up for full time on our attack. It's just like, come on, Abbott. We've had bad referees. We're due a break. Do you know what? Thing is I will take all these bad referee decisions as long as on Friday week that we get a referee who's the most biased homer ever.
I would take that as well. But it must be said that 2017 has been an annus horribilis, or whatever that phrase was, for us and referees, yes. Isn't it? Going all the way back to Sutton United and many, many games since. Anyway. We are trying to be positive, as I said at the start of the show. We are trying to be positive, positive, positive. Reasons to be cheerful. I have one. Harry Forrester.
Yeah, he's a nice chap, isn't he?
He's a nice chap. Do you know what? He reminds me of a young Stuart Ripley.
Really? He had lovely flowing hair, Stuart Ripley.
Stop going on about Stuart Ripley. You're never going to meet him.
Harry Forrester. Watch. The shot is just... I've watched it back. The 10 minutes, by the way, people are not on iFollow. The 10 minutes extended highlights is the best 10 minutes. Well, say the best 10 minutes. Sometimes that can be, you sometimes think, how have they got 10 minutes extended highlights from that game? But this game, obviously, against Gillingham, they got loads of action. The shot is just wow. And he had two shots. I actually forgot the second shot he had one hit the crossbar, which the keeper. By the time the keeper gets eyes on it, it's gone past him and it's a crossbar. And the second one he takes from distance, which the keeper just gladly pushes out for a free kick. For a goal kick, corner kick. 20 minutes. Did he get 20 minutes? 25 minutes?
Yeah, about that. Yeah.
But he'd done enough in there to go, crikey, we've got to see a lot more of him.
And obviously, of course, Anthony Hartigan. But I think we've all said everything we need to say about Anthony Hartigan, haven't we? The manager said it. All the other players have said it. This is a 17-year-old that looks like he's a 25-year-old on that pitch.
Yeah, he does. I don't want to say I told you all so, but I did. I said you last year, didn't I? Said we got some player in the use. We saw a nice little touching moment. We did say this on Facebook Live again, but Jeremy Sawyer, as proud as anything, with Anthony Hartigan, gave him a good old cuddle after the game on Tuesday night. It's so nice to see because he's only just left. The academy, the kid has literally left the academy in the summer and he is now playing in front of, be generous, 4,000 fans who absolutely will cheer everything he does. He's got a great future ahead of him.
I'd love to speak to Neil Ardley and see what he does with Anthony Hartigan in training, because it must be a difficult player to manage in that respect, because you've still got someone that's developing. Obviously, technically and what have you, he's years ahead of his actual age, but he's got to be doing all the technical things and the tactical things that you work on and shape and things like that, but he also needs to develop as well. Do you think it's a difficult balance in that regard?
Joe, what I think is, I don't think actually Anthony Hartigan knows how good he is. I really don't.
No, that's probably fair.
I don't think he knows how good he is. I saw a good 15 games last year of him playing, and he can play 10 yards further forward than what he is at the moment. He can easily play 10 yards further forward, and he's got a great shot on him. You know, I've seen him score a 40-yarder against Gillingham. I remember it very well, just nonchalantly. He can knock the 30-yard balls. He can dictate a game. He's got a lot to his game. I think, yes, he's not... Funny thing is, actually, you look at him and he's not... Alfie Egan, when he came in last year, not to compare the two, because they're different types of players, but you can't help because they've both come through our academy. Where you felt Alfie Egan was a small 17-year-old and had to really bulk up. Actually, Andy Harskin isn't actually that small when you look at him. You know, if you compare him against some midfielders, he must be 5'11", I think, 5'10", 5'11". He will naturally fill out. You know, we've seen players now naturally fill out as they come through. Will Nightingale, if you look at Will Nightingale or Ryan Swinger, I know they're centre-halves, but if you remember when Will and Ryan come in, they were like sticking sets, weren't they? And they just fill out because, you know, between 17, 18, 19, your body does. I think him is just really getting him involved in patterns of play, what he wants him to do, and beefing his stuff up. But you sort of really don't want to go on too much about him because we must be getting scouts coming down. If we haven't got scouts coming down, they're going to be flocking down in King's Meadow, aren't they?
Well, I was sat next to Ray Arnfield on Tuesday night, and actually just prior to kickoff, I think he gave me a little nudge and sort of said, "The guy two seats over is a scout." And my first reaction was Hartigan, and then Ray did a little bit more digging, and yes, indeed, he was there for Anthony Hartigan, but we don't know where from at the moment. But anyway. Running late, as always, but...
Sounding great.
Well done, yeah. Simple question, yes or no answer. Is 20th place our aspiration for this season?
No.
You think we can... Okay, I'm going to keep going up. I'm going to go up in league table places, and I want you to stop me when I get to a league place that you think should be our aspiration. Okay, not where you think we'll finish, what we should be aspiring to. Okay, so if it's not 20th, I'm going to say 19th, 18th, 17th, 16th, 15th?
Yes, 15th.
There you go. I was beginning to worry there. I was just thinking it's going to be the most boring moment of the podcast ever when I get to third. And you're like, yeah, we're going to finish third. Yeah, no problem.
Because aspirations is where you want, you know, is your what you want to hope to achieve. And if we've got a women's team that's hoping to achieve 20th, then we have something seriously wrong.
Yes, but I do worry. But anyway, let's move on. Let's be positive. Let's have some three-word reports. They're always positive, aren't they, from Twitter? This is for the Portsmouth game early this week. So at 9YRS podcast, hashtag Don's three-word report. And three that I liked this week. We have loads, by the way. So thank you very much to everyone that responded to these on Twitter. These were great. And if you search for hashtag Don's three-word report and find our thread that we put up for the Portsmouth game and read through the responses, they were the best we've ever had, I think. So thank you very much to everyone. If we could read them all out, I would, but just the three as usual. Let's start with Michael at Shep Zillion, who went for Kennedy was assassinated. Love that.
That's probably one of the best ones, actually.
I know. Do you know what? I wanted to use it, but I thought it doesn't actually give a report on the match, if you know what I mean.
Or was it Clash of Heads? Should we describe it as a Clash of Heads, as the official site has?
A Clash of Heads, as the official site very politically correctly said. Yes, Matt Griffin at Matt Might Say. If you don't follow Matt on Twitter, I would recommend you do. He's very, very funny on there. He went for sunny, rainy, shitty. Yeah.
I know we should laugh, right? But they're always better when we lose the three words, aren't they? Do you know what I mean?
Yes, I think.
They're always a bit more sarcastic and a bit more fun.
A little bit more witty, yes. And finally,
yes.
On that note.
Yeah, I would agree.
Dave Abbott at Ratty75, he went for, and I've used this as my favourite because it sums up pretty much our performances over the first six games of the season, where's the fun? Because as we were saying, going to watch us at King's Meadow before Tuesday night, to be fair, when there was actually a bit of entertainment, it's been dire going to watch us, hasn't it? So
yeah, I've got more fun taking the mick out of George's hair, if I'm being truthful. So George is pretty happy that we're playing better.
George Franken or George Jones?
George Jones, always taking the mick out of his permed haircut.
Kevin Keegan is jealous because he can't grow it like that anymore. Anyway, very, very quickly, Stu, elsewhere in League One, we had two match days, didn't we, this week? So instead of picking out results per se, I'm going to ask you which team had the best week, in your opinion?
Yeah, for me, I'm probably sound like a bit of a broken record, but Shrewsbury had a great week this week. Not conceding a goal at all, beating Wigan at home 1-0, and then beating Southend. Who, if I'm not mistaken, I think we're both in my at least in the top six to finish this year. So they probably beat two top six contenders at the start of the season at home. Doing really well.
It will never last. It's like Rachel and Joey. It will never last.
There's always one team, isn't there? Fleetwood last year's team, wasn't there? That had a bit of a challenge. Shrewsbury might be the one this year.
My pick was Oldham, because they got their first win. They got a point away at Fleetwood on the Saturday as well. So they've taken 4 points after a very bad start to the season. And you know what? I think we have to be mindful, because everyone's predicted Oldham to go down. But John Sheridan was very, very busy in the final days of the transfer market, and I think he's picked up some very good young players, and Oldham are not going to be... I don't think we should write them off, that's all I'm going to say. If you're looking for four teams to finish below us, Oldham would be everyone's pick. I'm not so sure anymore. But anyway, who did you think had the worst week?
Yeah, I've gone for Southend.
I wondered about that.
They've not scored. They've only scored one goal in September. So you know, we talk about shots.
Imagine that. Imagine going like a month only scoring once. I mean, it could only be worse going a whole month. Oh, carry on.
But you know, this week they've lost away to Charlton. There's no shame in that. And by the way,
they had two tough games, didn't they? They had Shrewsbury and Charlton away.
Yeah, but a Southend team that's had a really bad start to the season. You know, yeah. Phil Brown must be panicking. To be fair, Phil Brown does get sacked. He just goes and tops his tan up, doesn't he? Do you know what I mean?
That's why he's called... Do you know what? 10 years ago, he was Phil White.
He was, probably. I think they've had a really, really bad week. Don't get me wrong. Yeah, Charlton's a tough game. And anyone who hasn't seen Ricky Holmes' goal, I know we don't like him going back to Chelmsford days, but what a player he's turned into. How Charlton are keeping hold of him at the moment, I don't know. But he's scoring goals for fun at the moment. It's some real quality goals. But yeah, I just think Southend have got a really... Southend, if they don't start getting some results together, Phil Brown will be under pressure if he's not already. What about yourself, mate?
I've gone for Plymouth. I am a big fan of Plymouth. I like Plymouth. I've been down there many, many times to go and watch them play, but they've had two home games in the past week. They've lost them both. They've had players sent off, I think, for three consecutive games, and they are struggling big time. And you don't want to have them work so hard to get out of League Two. They really don't want to be involved in a scrap to avoid having to go straight back down there. So they need to start picking up or finding their form very, very quickly. Talking about being very, very quick, again, we're not going to really explain these. I don't think we have to, probably, our heroes and villains of this week. So just the names, please. First, your hero.
I don't know the name of the person, because my one is a CNN reporter who was live in the eye of the hurricane in Naples, in Florida. He was literally reporting live, being blown everywhere for about 2 hours. I don't know what his name is, but that's my hero of the week.
His name was Matt Hardy.
Cool. Well done, Matt Hardy.
Who is your villain?
Steve Parrish, who's a Palace chairman, for just proving how ridiculous this brilliant English Premiership is, sacking a manager after four games. You were the one that recruited him. You should go as well.
Fair enough. My hero was Anthony Hartigan. Don't need to explain any more than that. And my villain was Kevin Johnson, the referee for the Portsmouth game. I don't think I need to add any more explanations to either of those.
No, you don't.
Well done, Matt Hardy.
You're listening to these fine gentlemen and their new song, One Horse Town. Available now on iTunes and Spotify.
Right, we've been joined by Blackburn Rovers fan and host of the Rovers Chat podcast, Daniel Ainsworth, to preview Saturday's game at Ewood Park and also catch up with how things are going on at Rovers, considering all the problems they've had over the last few years with ownership and a couple of relegations and things. It's not been the greatest few seasons, Daniel, I think that's fair to say.
Yeah, it is, yeah. It's quite surreal how far we've fallen in time. Like, when they come in 2010, we thought we'd be probably going up the table rather than be playing away at clubs like Scunthorpe like we did last night and Rochdale on Saturday. It's just mad how far we've fallen.
What's the situation with the ownership now then? Is it just very much a status quo at the time being? Is it a case of fans are now sort of staying away a bit and protest, or what's the general feeling around the ground?
There's a few who are staying away. They say in protest, but there are a few that are just not bothering to go because it's not Premier League. But then, we've got about 8,000 who are like the core fans, and it probably dropped down a bit if we were further down, but around 8,000 are main home support. So it's all right, but considering we used to get 25,000 at home, it's unbelievable how much it's dropped. Like, you can feel it now on match days when you're round the ground, and like you used to, once you've been down there at 1 o'clock, it were absolutely packed. Now there's no one to be seen until half two. It's just mad.
Because it's a big stadium. I was looking through some of the stats, actually, and you're right, 25,000 back in 2010 when the Wenger owners come in. And I was looking at the moment this season, 11,000, only three games, so it's difficult to go into but you know, three home games, 11,000 average attendance, and a 35% full. So, do you think this season, you know, in terms of us as Wimbledon fans, it's interesting the difference between that, because obviously you're probably right in saying, you know, you're going, rather than going to Old Trafford and St James's Park, you're going to Scunthorpe and Rochdale. With no disrespect to those clubs, but that's a little bit different to what you're used to. But are you getting any clubs coming to you now going, you're the big boys now? Do you think, are you finding that a little bit?
Yeah, I think, well, everyone wants to come to us and beat us now, don't they? Like, a win at Blackburn this year is going to be like a win at Newcastle was last year in Championship. So, I mean, it's like when Doncaster come to our ground and beat us 3-1. I think if you'd have asked any Doncaster fan before getting there, they thought we'd have won as well. So everyone wants to come and win, and I think teams will give a little bit more now when they come to us.
So do you think your away form might be better than your home form? I know, obviously, you have one at home, haven't you? I know you beat...
MK Dons.
You beat them.
Be very careful with that. Just Milton Keynes will be fine. Or Franchise, or Scum, anything like that.
But do you find it maybe away performance... Do you think the pressure could... Do you think the team may find any pressure, or have you noticed any pressure in that? Because it's an empty stadium. Let's be fair, you know, 25,000 back in the Premiership.
Yeah, it's really empty now. And I don't know, it's a bit like... I think the problem is we've still got every stand still open. So it's hard to get an atmosphere going, and it's hard to just really, like... It's a bit weird, like, fans are separated in separate parts. But when we played Burnley at home in the Carabao Cup in second round, you could feel atmosphere there. And obviously that was when everyone were more pushed together because they had the entire away stand. So I think if everyone were together, then it'd be a bit more like of a fortress and a place to come. But atmosphere is terrible. You'll probably see it on Saturday.
The thing is, you might not think of it from your perspective, but I can see a lot of parallels between our two clubs in the sense that we had periods at Selhurst Park many years ago where we were in a similar situation, very, very low crowds in a fairly big stadium. So probably about a similar size stadium, actually, thinking about it. And we'd be getting sort of 10,000 or 8,000, or in the case, Stu, if you remember Wigan, towards the end there, we got just under 2,000 people in that stadium. Yeah, which was ludicrous. But also we've had the same thing of being, when we were coming up through the non-leagues, a big club at those levels where it was everybody's cup final, so everyone would come down to our stadium, the best stadium and the biggest stadium in those divisions. Trust me, if you're coming down to King's Meadow this season, if Rochdale and Scunthorpe are bad, you're in for a hell of a shock, I've got to be honest with you. It's not good, but but yes, we have that. We know what it's like, and we know it's going to be difficult for you. But you've picked up on... I know we're sort of skipping around different subjects here, but you have picked up since you first started off with two defeats, obviously, but you've picked up four on the bounce now. Do you find that you've found your feet at this level?
I don't know. It's still hard to tell. I think, like, we went to Bradford and won 1-0, and then beat Milton Keynes 4-1 at home, and then Rochdale Saturday with 3-0 last night with 1-0. So we've picked up, but I don't think we're adapted yet to the league. Like, if we come up against someone like Shrewsbury, we've got them in a week's time, and if they had the same chances Scunthorpe had yesterday, would have got beat. Like, they were all over us in first half, really bad.
Yeah, because I was looking at your updates on your Twitter, really good updates as well, and you sort of said that they had lots of chances. So, was it a deserved win at Scunthorpe?
At the end it was. At half-time, I'd have been happy with a 0-0, or, like, just to get out of that game without losing would have been good. But second half, we showed what quality we have on bench, really. Like, we spent $750,000 on Bradley Dack, and he sat on bench every week.
Is he really?
He picked up an injury at Southend, and then he come back for Bradford, picked up an injury, and he's been on bench ever since. So, yeah, it's a weird one because we've got, like, Danny Graham on bench, who's obviously, he can score goals. He were a top scorer last year. So I just think, but then when you've got other people like Samuel and Antonsen scoring, it just shows the quality we have, and we should be able to, like, if we did end up going one down on Saturday, then we should be able to bring it back when we got Dak and Graham and Harry Chapman and Peter Whittingham and we've just got a really strong bench. So I think it should come through, like, especially when it starts to become Saturday, Tuesday constantly, then we should start showing how good a squad is.
So how is the squad this year? Because I see you lost quite a few players. I'd imagine you probably had quite a few players on decent contracts in the Championship. When I look at Blackburn, and I must say, I was looking, obviously, before we got together, I just had a quick look, and I was amazed when I looked at 2010, was when they come in. It's nearly like 7 years now. Does anyone know what their end game is? Because obviously you're now in League One, so you've gone from a Premiership to Championship. To have they looked at selling, or what's their end? Does anyone know what their end game is?
I honestly don't think anyone does. Well, when they come in, I don't know if you've heard it, but they didn't know what relegation was. They didn't know you could get relegated from Prem.
Yeah, I've heard this. Yeah.
So they come in and I don't know what they're aiming for. I think what they're going to try and do now is that since we spent money this summer, I think they're going to try and get back up to Premier League, spend a year there, because obviously Prem's worth 200 million now or whatever it is. And then I think they'll take the debt because they got £120 million debt in the club. I think they'll just take that back and then sell the club, because I don't think they want to leave until they've got the money back. But that could be 20 years off, it could be 30 years, it just depends.
Is that how much we're in debt then, £120 million?
I think it's about £120 million now. It's all to the, I think most of it's to, like, it's actually two Venkies, do you know, money they put in club.
Okay.
But so they won't leave unless someone either come in and paid £120 million to them to cover the debt. Which no one's going to do. No one's going to pay £120 million for a League One club. So I think they're just going to try and hold it out until we get to the Prem and then decide from there whether to keep it or sell it.
So what's... Because there's a lot of still... You talk about the squad and your six figures... Well, nearly seven figures. You're playing for Bradley Dack and things like that. And the squad, you mentioned the names, there's quality in there. So, looking from outside, we sort of see the ownership problems and things and think that investment's dried up and what have you, and that seems to be the case in the Premier League. So, what happened last season? What went wrong for you on the pitch?
Well, I think it all went down because of Owen Coyle, just appointing him. Just, like, there's already a massive gap between supporters and club, and then they've just gone and appointed an ex-Burnley manager, biggest rivals, and he's got no, like... The only thing he's done is take Burnley up to Premier. We're bottom of the MLS with Houston Dynamo, and it was one of the most stupidest appointments I've ever seen, because it's widened the gap between us. And I think if we'd have had Tony Mowbray last year, we'd be going places like Sunderland this year, and we'd be going to Derby and Hull rather than having to go down to smaller teams and smaller grounds. No disrespect at ground, but we should be playing at a higher level, really. Really, we're too big for the league, but then, end of the day, we're in this league, so we've got to get back out of it before we can do anything else.
Yeah.
So what grounds are you looking, in terms of away games, are you going to the away games this year?
I've been to them all so far this year.
So I'd imagine then, when you looked at the fixtures at the beginning of the season, what grounds were you looking forward to attend, if that's the word?
I quite like the smaller grounds, though. Like, you know, the lesser, smaller ones. Like, Fleetwood, I'm looking forward to. I think Wimbledon should be a good day, really. I think we've got you and Fleetwood in the same month. And then I'm also looking forward to... we've got Blackpool, Oldham and Wigan next month. There are three away games. So them three should be...
Oh, okay.
Them three should be good, but... We've been to Blackpool and Wigan before, and... Been Oldham in pre-season, but... Looking forward to them kind of games, because if it's anything like Rochdale was on Saturday, then it should be a really good day.
I warn you, I know I've already referenced it and talked about it, but when you do come down to us this season, just brace yourself, honestly. Norbiton is not a place anyone really wants to spend their Saturday afternoons or any time of their life, really. But anyway, the thing is, you're right, there's a lot of small grounds in this league, like you say, but they're tight to the pitch and you can get a really good atmosphere. Oldham will be a great one for you guys, I think, in terms of atmosphere and stuff. I think that'll be a really good one. I imagine Scunthorpe was a great atmosphere last
it
night.
It was, yeah.
Tuesday night for you, I should say. I mean, you talk about distance, though, between yourselves and the club. And Tony Mowbray, then, has he actually... How has he brought things close together? How do you feel? What has he brought that previous managers perhaps haven't? I'm thinking, who did you have? Gary Bowyer, for instance, or like you say, Owen Coyle?
Yeah, Paul Lambert, we've had him in. I don't know. I think he might have gone to... He went over to India this summer for talks, and I think he might have gone over and told them, this is what we have to do to get back up. Because there was talks about him possibly leaving if he didn't get what he wanted in the summer. So, I mean, I think he's just gone over and told them that if they don't take the chance with him and don't put money in, then they're never going to get back what they want for the club. And, like, when he reappointed, I don't think many fans were happy with him. But he's coming in, he's now that link between India and us. Like, he's made us forget a bit. Like, some of the fans have forgot about what's gone on in India. Now they're fully behind him. And, like, this year we'll end up taking more to places than we would have done last year. So, like, I think we took 1,500 to Southend, and if it wasn't Mowbray in charge and we were going that distance, we'd have struggled to take 600-700 probably down there. Mm-hmm. But he's really got the fans together, and I think that's why our home attendance is around what it was last year, because of him. If it wasn't for him, I don't think there'd be... I think there'd be about 5,000-6,000 on, and he's just united the fans. And the team, like, it feels a bit more like our Rovers team now rather than being owned by some Indians who aren't bothered about us.
Yeah, I must admit, I think last season you played Manchester United, didn't you? You had an FA Cup tie with them. I know it's always difficult to judge when you play any Premier League team in that sort of situation, certainly Manchester United, because of course every player raises their game, of course they do. But you didn't strike me, I must admit, as a team that should be in any trouble when I watched that game. I thought you had a lot of quality, and I think that was proved as well on the last day, wasn't it? You went to Brentford and you got a win, which wasn't enough in the end, but... The expectation, of course, is to go straight back up. But what's happened in pre-season, and aside from signing players like Dak, has much changed in the squad? Has it been a massive overhaul, or have you kept that sort of nucleus together?
Well, we've always been, like, since we went down for Prem, we've always struggled in the centre of midfield. Like, last year we had Jason Law, Hopak Pan, Danny Guthrie, and they've all gone. They're all released from the contract. And we didn't get enough goals from centre mid last year. Like, we got, I think we got 3 all season. And we've already got 3 this season with the, we brought Richie Smallwood in from Rotherham. But Bradley Dack from Gillingham, Ben Gladwin from QPR, Peter Whittingham from Cardiff. Mm. And I think it's right what people have been saying. We've got a better midfield now than we did last year. Like, it's a really strong midfield. Like, Richie Smallwood and, Corey Evans together, if they play on Saturday, then we shouldn't have any problems. It's just if one of them picks up an injury, I think that's when we'll fall.
So, obviously, we travel to Ewood Park on Saturday. Nick, you're going along there. In terms of who, as Wimbledon fans, should we be hoping has an absolute mare that has been your sort of player that's making you tick? I know you've gone through your midfield, but is there any players that we should, if they have a mare, then it does affect your performance?
Charlie Mulgrew, a captain, 100%. Like, he wasn't playing at Rochdale and we did win 3-0, but we're just more composed and he brings kind of the international experience he's got. He just brings it to the back line and he slows the game down for us. When we kind of get the ball at goalkeeper when we're 1-up, 2-up, and we'll usually just try and get it up straight away and then we just lose it and then teams come back at us. Mulgrew just keeps it really calm and he makes sure that the defence knows what it's doing. And you can tell when you see Rovers play with him and when you see him without him, you can tell that he's not there. If we didn't have him this year, we'd be really struggling.
If we were to ask for a prediction for Saturday's game, what do you reckon?
I don't know if it's a go. Rovers win or a draw. When I say we win, we usually lose.
You're going to win.
I think I'd have to go with 3-1 probably, Rovers.
We'll take that because it means we've scored. It means we've had a shot. So.
I just think we should have enough quality to turn you over. I mean, like, if Samuel Ree finds his form for us, then he should be scoring. And we've now got goals from everywhere. Like, someone could come up from left back, right back. We've just got goals all around now, whereas previously we've always struggled scoring. Like, we've always had good strikers, but we've never had goal-scoring midfielders for 5-6 years now, so we should beat the 3-1 with the quality we've got now.
Stu, what do you reckon?
Yeah, if I was taking away the fact that I'm a Wimbledon fan, then you look at it, Blackburn should turn us over. I don't see nothing to change that. We played better on Tuesday night, and we looked like we had a bit of a fire in our belly. So if we can go up there with a bit of fire in our belly, but if I'm being true, I'll take a draw. I'd bite your hand off now and take a draw. But I would say probably, yeah, we're going to do well to get anything up at Ewood Park on Saturday.
Cool. Well, Daniel, thank you very much for your time. Before you go, we do have to ask one question. Well, actually, I've got a couple of questions. How long have you been a Blackburn fan now for?
It's about 14, 13 years now.
13, 14 years. OK, so I'm trying to think back just to some of the best players you might have seen at your time then watching. I'm thinking you're probably the Craig Bellamy team, I think. That sort of team?
Robbie, yeah, Sanders, around then, yeah.
Benny McCarthy?
Best player I've seen is probably Tugay.
Oh, yeah.
In a Rover shirt. He was just absolutely magic. If you had someone off of his quality now in Championship, you'd be one of the best players in that league.
Mm-hmm. See, my favourite player with Blackburn, I'm going back into the Premiership days, was always Stuart Ripley.
Oh, I'm too young to have seen him.
That's the most random thing anyone's ever said on this podcast.
He had the most lovely
Stuart Ripley.
He had the most lovely blonde hair. Him and Lee Wilcox on the other side used to terrorise most teams. But that shows how far I'm going back. But yeah, Stuart Ripley was always effortless.
Okay, that's weird. Yes, totally throwing me, I tell you. But I'm just thinking back to a 4-1. We'll always remember in the Premier League when we beat Rovers 4-1.
I think
when it's midweek at Selhurst Park, where Blackburn were going for the Championship, and we just turned up and turned them over, I'm afraid. But that's probably most of our fans' best memories of Blackburn, I think. Stuart, I can't think of, we didn't have particularly that great a record against them, to be honest.
No, basically they stopped us.
Yeah. And Dan, the last question I have to ask you is, you like a cup of tea, or should I say, I suppose I have to say a brew, don't I?
A brew, yeah.
Yeah, you like a brew. When you make your brew, do you put the bag in first and then the water in first, or do you put the milk in first?
The bag and the water, and then the milk.
Perfect, good man, sorted. Right, thank you very much.
And thank you.
All the best for the rest of the season, except for Saturday, of course.
Yeah, you too.
Boobs is what they want.
Jimmy Abdu is suspended, so again we had to look elsewhere for our game this week. And as much fun as we had last week with George Frankham dying with me, we like to mix it up on this show. So we have a new game this week. Very, very excited. And we're calling this game, Stu, Blantweeky Blank. Blantweeky Blank. Jaden and yeah, you get it. Music. I am going to give you three quotes in which I have blanked out the name of an AFC Wimbledon player, past or present. You just have to tell me which name I have blanked out. For each one you get correct, Stu, I will buy you a prize.
Okay.
So, for the first one, if you get the player's name correctly, I will buy you a Wimbledon pin badge.
Cool. Mm-hmm.
The quote is from Neil Ardley, and he said, following the Portsmouth game, I've seen it back, and it is a soft penalty. You see worse than that from every corner. Obviously, then, there was blank's moment.
There was blank's moments.
So he's talking about the penalty that was given against us, and then he said, then there was blank's moment.
I've probably listened to this quote, and I...
Do you want a clue? Think about penalties.
There was decisive moment.
No, because that's not the name of a player.
Oh, is it a name of a player?
Blimey. Yeah, I'm so glad I spent time explaining how to do this game, Stu. I blanked out the name of an AFC Wimbledon player, past or present.
There was blank moments. There were...
Then there was blank's moment. Okay, so think, he's talking about the penalty...
There was Taylor's moment, Lyle Taylor's moment.
There we go, well done. Right.
Such an easy game.
Oh, there's two more to come, Stu.
Oh, dear.
You really have made a rod for your own back there.
I know.
Number two, then. This is I will buy you a Wimbledon programme at a game of your choice. A game of your choosing, okay?
Yeah, I'm liking this.
Terry Brown said in 2009, I thought it was fitting that blank should score the equaliser from a Danny Kedwell cross.
2009. Mainly would have been about. Mainly would have been there, wouldn't he, then? John Main.
Two out of two. Well done, yes.
Of course it is, because them two are just the best friends, weren't they?
That was talking about the equaliser against Hampton and Richmond.
Oh, yes, I remember that.
Well, yeah, we all do. Cool. Right, number three, then. Get this, Chris, Stu, and I'll buy you a ticket to a Wimbledon game, a Wimbledon fixture.
Well, that's a prize, isn't it?
Yes, it is a prize.
I've got a season ticket, so that doesn't really count, does it?
Away games? Cup games?
Okay, yeah. All cup games, yes, that'd be good. First round.
John Turner, our former assistant manager, speaking in 2005, he said, Steve Butler and Anthony Howard are both very consistent performers, but this is a great opportunity for people like Wayne Finney and blank to come in and make their places their own.
Oh, wow. 2005. Who was around about that? Wayne Finney. Who would have been a centre-half back then? Nah, you've done me. I can't think that far back.
It must be a name, a defender's name, come on, from that sort of time.
Ben Judge.
Oh, dear. You've missed out. You've missed out on your ticket, I'm afraid, Stu. It was Simon Sabihi.
Oh, give in.
I thought you might get that.
I know. I recognise the player now. Well, if I saw him now, I wouldn't, but... Crikey, that's a name from the past, isn't it? That's cruel, though. So, Simon Sahibi, crikey. I wonder how many people actually would get that.
What, Simon Sabihi?
Yeah, we should get them to Twitter in.
That's what we're going to do it from now on. Twitter in to the podcast. Oh, wow. Well, talking of Twitter, actually, there will be updates from our game at Ewood Park on Saturday, available on Twitter this Saturday, at 9Wireless Podcast, Instagram as well. There might be Facebook Live videos, but as always with away games, that comes with a disclaimer, because we never know quite what will happen in terms of network coverage and all that like. So we will be keeping you posted, definitely, though, on Twitter and Instagram. And remember to like us on Facebook, facebook.com/9Wireless Podcast. We've already previewed the game, talking to Dan Ainsworth from... Blackburn Rovers. So very quickly, Stu, other games in League One that you'll be looking out for on the weekend?
Yeah, so looking out for Oldham versus Shrewsbury. Just because Oldham, as you rightly said, picked up a result in the week, and Shrewsbury are still unbeaten in the league and top of the league. So looking at that one. And also, well, actually, no. I think that's the only one I'm looking out for, actually. There isn't really much. Probably also looking at them playing on Saturday, just to make sure they get any injuries or suspensions, because I'm horrible like that.
Yeah, we have to be careful as well, because Dead Josh Elijah, we didn't mention, so he got booked, didn't he, on Tuesday night. So if he gets booked against Blackburn, he will be suspended, I believe, for that game.
Yeah, so do you... And that's the thing, isn't it? You don't want to... Not that game on Friday week should be the all of an end all of the season, but it is a big game, isn't it? You want to win. That could define... Really, our form up to Christmas, that's how big a result it could be to beat them.
Other games I'm looking forward to: Bury versus Plymouth. I always seem to pick Bury, but two teams struggling, so it's bottom of the league sort type of game, and they'll both be desperate to pick up points there. And Southend versus Northampton, because you mentioned Southend early, didn't you? And they've got off to a poor start. Northampton 2-2 since Jimmy Floyd Hasselbaink took over, so... Be very interested to see what happens between those two. Before we sign off, we have to run through some announcements. We have the winner of our Goal of the Month competition for August, which was put together and run by Mark Hendricks. So thank you very much, Mark. It was a close run thing, but with 44% of the vote. Congratulations to Andy Bartram for your goal against Doncaster Rovers. That was the winner of our Goal of the Month competition for August. Well done, Andy. Speaking of Mark Hendricks, his article is up. The weekly article on 9wirespodcast.org is up, where Mark has examined our potential starting lineups and formations with the current squad. Another win for the ladies, 3-1 against Denham ladies. Ended up there with somewhere near Uxbridge, I believe, in the end. But no, I really don't know. Well done, ladies. 3-1 win, third win on the trot in all competitions. This Sunday, they will host Luton Town at Gander Green Lane. Huge game. What a game that will be. Free entry if you'd like to go down to Sutton United for a 2 p.m. kickoff. So if you are free on Sunday, the ladies deserve and would appreciate your support. Right, off we go. Thank you for listening, and please remember to like us and subscribe to us on either iTunes or YouTube, however you are listening to us, or if you are on our website, 9yrfpodcast.org, just leave us a comment, give us your opinion, tell us what you think. But that is it for us this week. Thank you to Stu for joining me.
Thank you.
And thank you very much for listening. Join us next week when we'll be talking to the new Crystal Palace manager, Roy Hodgson, where, well, to be honest with you, we just hope he's still in a job by the time we speak to him. We'll also be talking to Stuart Ripley about the restraining order he's placed on one Mr. Stuart Deakins. Alexa Bliss, bag first, milk last, and we will speak to you again next week. Sweet time.